Hello, welcome back, you other voters. Glad to see you're back online. Sorry for the rush, but we've got to move. We've been going through Mina's notes from her lab, and from what I can tell, she attempted a, well, a free dive over the drop-off. That's why she left her suit behind. She must have opened it up and descended. I know what you're thinking. There's no way she could free dive thousands of meters to the ocean floor. But that's what she did, willingly, and we are going after her. We need to dive now. I've been working on the suit and it's almost ready. I've used sections of Minae's failed hard suit to modify our suit. Now it's full atmospheric dive suit. Internally, we should be able to maintain one atmosphere of pressure for me and that casing of yours. It will work just like before, but our depth rating is massively increased. We can hit 2, maybe 3,000 meters. The suit is in the bay, so load whatever samples you need. I've marked the drop-off on the map. You can dive there directly and search for any evidence there. I have no idea why she would do this. It's suicide, but she seemed to be able to believe she could do it. Get ready to go. I'll be waiting. Sampling and analyzing bubble probes from the bloom shows that they are a form of algae, but with incredible adaptability. They have a distinctive chemical structure, but notable to the study of bloom veins is the presence of a compound similar to domoic acid with bloom bubbles. Domoic acid is a neurotoxin known to produce memory loss and confusion in animals, which suggests that the erratic and frantic feeding behavior of bloom veins and feeding is really a form of frenzy brought on by the consumption of the neurotoxin. How this process is embedded to the bloom veins is unclear. The volumes of neurotoxin they are consuming are vast, enough to kill a human adult. Perhaps if I can directly examine a bloom vein, or at least its shell, I can understand their resistance. Analysis of weaver specimens show them to be shelled creatures with a set of jointed mandibles, which they use to handle their threads. These threads are the most fascinating aspect of the weavers. They are silk, but lined with a type of bacteria which lives inside the mouthparts of the weaver. When the threads are produced, they are coated with this bacteria, which aggressively consumes the microbial growth of the bloom. While not producing silk, this bacteria is kept alive by scavenging on the food that the weavers eat, taking their share from particles stuck on the weavers' mouthparts. However, analysis of the weavers themselves still gives no idea of what might lie in their nest. They protect these nests aggressively, but if I could find an abandoned one, it may be possible to sample. The pieces of weaver nest we found offer an insight into the weaver's protective behavior. Wrapped in its threads are thousands of weaver eggs. This suggests that like ants or termites, weavers are eusocial species, with many generations of weavers protecting and maintaining a single reproductive female. These weaver queens must be somewhere within the active weaver nests, protected by layers of silken threads and weaver workers. Nest fragments also reveal that the weavers farm their own food within the nest structure, carefully maintaining tubular fields of microbes, which through the weavers' careful cultivation seem to produce oxygen rather than the toxins that poison the bloom. How can this be possible? Study of a piece of bloom fan stem reveals that below the sand, a bloom fan has four jointed legs and a head with a circular mouth. Using these, the bloom fan scrapes through rock and sand in order to extract minerals and biological compounds. Bloom fans may feed on the roots or even the buried eggs of other bloom species. This source of nutrients, when supplemented by the oxygen gathered through its tail fan, which is in fact more of an external lung, is enough to sustain a blue fan for a long period, especially due to its mostly static lifestyle. What this also suggests is that there may be a larger subterranean ecosystem which remains undiscovered beneath the bloom. Is this where life has retreated in this toxic condition? These clusters of opaque green bubbles can be found clinging to surfaces in the greater areas of the bloom where currents do not disrupt their growth. They appear to be accumulations of the bloom's microbial growth. The green clouds that create this vast toxic cloud of anoxic ocean water. The bloom itself is a mysterious phenomenon similar to terrestrial algae bloom, hence the name Mina gave this part of Greece 667 cc's ocean, but far more potent in its strength and seemingly much longer lasting. As much of the life in this sector has adapted to these extreme conditions. The similarity to terrestrial blue-green algae, aka cyanobacteria, has led me to classify this species as bacterial, but this thesis needs to be tested. Perhaps by analyzing this froth, we can understand the underlying chemical processes taking place here. Laboratory analysis of the froth has shown that each large bead in the bloom froth is a single microbial colony, bound by a gelatinous film, much like terrestrial cyanobacteria by the order Nastocalis. However, unlike this terrestrial species, the bloom froth displays an incredible ability to actively modify their internal chemistry to whatever conditions they find themselves in. Most bloom froth appears to have diverted to consuming metallic compounds, found in unusual abundance in the region of the bloom, rather than sunlight. This had led to the bacteria outputting large volumes of neurotoxins rather than oxygen. It is this which has led the bloom both anoxic and toxic. To understand more, we need to find the source of this destructive bacteria. Mina is gone, and she's left behind one hell of a mess. This base is falling apart. Cannibalized to build way stations out in the ocean, the communications array sliced away, life support failing. Where did she even commandeer this research base from? There's no way Baikal would have supplied it willingly after what she did with them. What did she call me out here for? To witness her disappearance? Or did she simply want me to encounter, as she did, the impossible life of the ocean? How could it have gone ignored for hundreds of years of exploration and conquest? There are too many questions to even begin. All I can do is keep an account of what happens here, so that if I can't answer this question, someone else might. It will be weeks, maybe months, until the next ship passes close enough to pick up my shuttle transponder. Until then, I'm alone. This place is unbelievably important. Our first contact with life beyond Earth. But something else is happening here too, and I need to know what it is. We got everything from here. I think we should go this room. Wait. Let's ask the loss of oxygen. Fuel. Which ones I need to leave? We need to go down and slide to the right to get it. I think it's possible. Unless it's not so obvious and it's gonna be to the left. fast. Although it's a shame that we couldn't upgrade our suit to withstand the gloom, the bloom, the gloom. The left, I think. I think there should be someone here, but it is not. Already too far down. Turning it away. We are back at the beginning already. There's nothing here. It's right. Let's go back and we need to look at some points of interest that we can look at while traveling. Let's look at it once again. It's over here. Maybe we need to go down here. After all. So we've been all the way to the to here. Something. Okay, now we can try. Wait. Okay, now we can try. We'll go down from the left side. It's strange. It's so. Well, it's elevated. I think we need to go to take approach it from the left side after all. Okay. show like those samples. Straight away. And for this, I have no idea where we are. It's so hard to tell. Oh, god damn it. I kept that one. Sample. Is there anything to be found here? I'm just wondering why we're in this green desert. Scorch into the rock, this wide crater lit with blue flares, broken stone, and something smoother, shinier below. Here the bloom has gone deeper into the rock, revealing strangely smooth surfaces like the inside of an oyster shell. The reflected light of the bubble falls across the surface of the silt. On the pitted surface of the scorched shell, the lack of current has well sealed together into soft piles. Emerging out from the silt, this rock looks almost like a fossil flower blooming from a sticky stem. That's the problem. This is the way. We've been up over there. We've been down there. The problem is we've been everywhere. This place? Oh no, this is the fence. We are way beneath it already. Because we can't cut. But I think that's gonna be a good place to end this part. We need one less entry. Sampling and analyzing bubble growths from the bloom shows that they are formed of algae, but with incredible adaptability. They have a distinctive chemical structure, but notable to the study of bloom veins is the presence of a compound similar to... Wait, we find that. It's going... It's stranger and stranger. Okay. So that's gonna do it for today. Let's take all of those and just see what we have. We can. Or not. Okay, so that's gonna be it for today. For now, thank you very much. Stay alive and see you soon. Bye!